Good evening, and thank you everyone for being here tonight on this great occasion, a celebration of a new chapter, or 53 to be precise, in American art history, with the publication of Mary Gabriel's latest book, Ninth Street Women, Lee Krasner, Elaine de Kooning, Grace Hartigan, Joan Mitchell, and Helen Frankenthaler, five painters and the movement that changed modern art. My name is Kim Conaty, and I'm the Stephen and Ann Ames Curator of Drawings and Prints at the Whitney. And it is my great pleasure to introduce tonight's conversation and our distinguished guests, acclaimed author Mary Gabriel and art critic and biographer Deborah Solomon. Their discussion will focus on the lives and careers of five artists forging their way through the emergent New York art scene of the 1950s, at the very moment of its ascendance. That these artists were women, called by then Art News editor Thomas Hess the, quote, sparkling Amazons who emerged in the flower of American painting, makes their stories even more remarkable, a point that Mary Gabriel deftly develops as she chronicles these inspiring and complex lives through interwoven narratives that give vibrancy and humanity to the brief mentions commonly found in art history textbooks. In doing so, Gabriel offers a new lens through which to examine the much-studied post-war period, and to, as the New York Times has recently lauded of the book, newly illuminate the milieu and upend its cliches. Tonight at the Whitney, we'll hear more about these five artists, Lee, Elaine, Grace, Joan, and Helen, if I may adopt Gabriel's first name basis with her artists, maybe I should say Mary's first name basis with her artists. These artists were linked not always by friendship or even support of each other's work within the competitive landscape, but by a shared, unequivocal devotion to their work and by, as Mary has argued, quote, courage, a spirit of rebellion, and a commitment to create. They are also linked by a common event, the Ninth Street Show, the raucous, artist-initiated show that came together for 1 month in May 1951 in an abandoned storefront on East 9th Street, in which they all, five of the 11 women included in the 72 artist show, made a splash. We'll hear more about that event tonight. At the time of the 9th Street show, the Whitney Museum of American Art was just a stone's throw away, still in its original home at 8 West 8th Street, where it had been founded by its own remarkable woman artist who helped develop the downtown artistic scene as well, Gertrude Vanderbilt Whitney, the beginning of a legacy of dedicated female leaders and supporters, later known as the, quote, Whitney women. 1 year after the 9th Street show, Joan Mitchell's work would be featured at the Whitney for the first time in the 1952 annual. An auspicious debut that led to her inclusion in no fewer than 10 annuals and biennials and 3 solo exhibitions. The Whitney has proudly hosted solo exhibitions of work by Helen Frankenthaler and Lee Krasner, and each of the Ninth Street women is represented in the Whitney collection, 3 with works acquired at the time they were made in the 1950s. For tonight, we're happy to count Lee, Elaine, Grace, Joan, and Helen among our Whitney women. Now to briefly introduce our guests tonight. Mary Gabriel is the author of Ninth Street Women, of course, and also the author of Love and Capital, Karl and Jenny Marx and the Birth of a Revolution, which was a finalist for the Pulitzer Prize, the National Book Award, and the National Book Critics Circle Award, as well as of Notorious Victoria, The Life of Victoria Woodhull, Uncensored, and The Art of Acquiring, a portrait of Etta and Claribel Cohn. She worked in Washington and London as an editor at Reuters for nearly 2 decades and currently lives in London. So thank you for being here tonight. Deborah Solomon is the art critic for WNYC and a longtime contributor to the New York Times among many publications. She's a longtime scholar of American painting and the prize-winning author of Jackson Pollock, a biography, Utopia Parkway, The Life and Work of Joseph Cornell, and American Mirror, The Life and Art of Norman Rockwell. And she is currently at work on a biography of Jasper Johns, which we're all excited to see. Finally, we'd like to offer a special thanks to the Helen Frankenthaler Foundation and the Joan Mitchell Foundation for their collaboration and support of tonight's event. We're also thrilled to have members of many of these artist family here with us tonight to celebrate. Now please join me in welcoming Mary Gabriel and Deborah Solomon.
Thank you. I know so many people here tonight, I feel like we should just pop open the wine and have a party. But thank you for coming to listen to us. And I want to start by saying, Mary, I think that your book is remarkably timely, because there were times, many times in the past, when if you tried to describe certain artists as women artists, there would be a revolt. Any of the artists in this book certainly would have resisted the label. Lee Krasner always said, I'm not a woman artist, I'm an artist. Grace Hartigan always said, I'm not a woman artist, I'm not even an artist, I'm a painter. They hated the designation, and you can see why. It was very limiting, and it implied that their work contained female subjects, perhaps, like flowers or female anatomy. And they wanted to transcend gender and the particularities of life, of course, and be transcendent. But now, this is 2018. It's an entirely different period. We're in the midst of an incredible revolution, really. And I think that the label women's painter really is a tribute. And it has nothing to do with the content of the work, but rather their social position and what they required, what was required for them to overcome obstacles and become painters. So we assume now that there is a commonality between women artists, whereas they themselves might not have felt close to one another. So I think it was really daring of you to write a book about women only. Women only. And how? What gave you the idea?
Well, it started with an interview I did with Grace Hartigan in 1990, and I'd been an fine arts student and took a lot of art history classes. And the story she told me about the abstract expressionist period, you know, was the story of the men we all know, the de Koonings, the Pollocks, the Larry Rivers, the Franz Kleins. But then she talked about her friends or the women she worked with, and though some of the names were familiar, the way she described them as being, you know, right in the mud with their male colleagues, you know, that they were all working together and they were part of this really vibrant community, I realized that part of the story I'd never been told. And it was so passionate and so much fun and so wild. And also, I have to tell you that as a young art student, you know, this was in the mid-80s, there were still a lot of guys walking around trying to be Jackson Pollock, or even one kid wanted to be Picasso so much that he changed his name to Pablo.
But that'll do it.
Yeah, but yeah, it didn't work. But the thing is that for me as a young woman artist, there was nobody I could look up to and think, you know, I would like to be like her. I would like to be cool like that person. And so when Grace was telling me this story, I thought, well, you know, there was this whole host of characters that I know nothing about. And so that's what gave me the idea. That was in 1990, but my life changed quite a bit, and I didn't start until 2011. Mm-hmm. And I think that what I tried to do was focus on them as women, but not really think of it as ghettoizing them as women. I just wanted to tell the fuller story, and this half of the story had been told. So I wanted to complete the picture and tell the other half, not either or, but all together.
Well, the book has a remarkable richness and fullness to it, as many reviewers have already noted. Congratulations for pulling it off. Should we introduce the artists one by one, perhaps, to this audience? At the risk of telling you things you already know, let's characterize Lee Krasner, for instance. You open the book with Lee Krasner. She's the oldest artist of the five, and it's interesting. They're all so memorable and so completely distinct from one another, and they didn't necessarily get along with one another either. I mean, we don't want to suggest that there was any kind of sisterhood in the 50s.
No,
there wasn't.
No.
I mean, they constantly criticized each other, right?
There were friends. Helen and Grace were quite close, and Elaine and Joan were surprisingly close. But
brief periods.
For brief periods, yeah. But Helen and Lee, Elaine and Lee were quite competitive with one another.
Right.
More so, I think, maybe on Lee's side than on than on Elaine's. So they were in and out of each other's lives. But you know, it's funny that when people talk about women, they expect that there would be a sisterhood, but we would never expect that of the men. You know, I mean, Pollock.
That's true. But I do think women of that generation, and correct me if I'm wrong, tended to need male adulation.
Yes.
And compete against one another more than women of my generation. I might be idealizing my generation, but I think as there are more opportunities for women, they don't necessarily need to attach themselves to important men. And one of the themes of the book, it's remarkable, is that, or a theme in art history, is that women painters often came as the appendage of a more famous male painter. And that wasn't always a recipe for success either. And to me, one of the really fascinating things in the book is, you know, I especially love the sections on Helen Frankenthaler and was just amazed at what she had to endure. She was the girlfriend briefly of Clement Greenberg. And when I was growing up, everyone always thought, oh, you know, Helen had such an advantage because of that. Because Clement Greenberg, of course, was the boss. He was the critic who could make and break careers with a single review. And reading your book, it was just so moving to realize what she had to put up with.
Yeah.
I mean, instead of enabling her, he was such an underminer.
Yes.
And just today, I took down my Greenberg, for his first collection, Art and Culture, was published in 1960. She's not even mentioned in it.
Yeah,
he never wrote about her.
Yeah, and I can see why, you know, they would have come to that agreement that he wouldn't write about her. But on the other hand, it's such an omission because she was such an important painter, and especially to the color field school. And also...
Right, so explain her achievement to everybody.
Yes.
Because of all the painters in the book, I think in a way she is the most radical. She is the one who started a new movement.
Yeah, she did start a new movement,
whereas
right.
Lee Krasner, you can see as a major abstract expressionist. Joan Mitchell, abstract expressionist with a strong passion for landscape and Europe.
Mm-hmm.
Grace was really atypical as an abstract expressionist,
right? And as was Elaine. Mm-hmm. But maybe we should, before we jump into Helen, maybe we should introduce Lee, just to get the chronology. Because when you talk about Lee, you know, she was an important abstract expressionist painter, and yet she was also had this other side that was, I think, so critical. And often when, in the history of the movement, she's introduced in 1941 or 1942 when Pollock shows up on the scene. But before Pollock was known at all, Lee was a formidable figure on the scene.
Mm-hmm.
And she had a role as an agitator and an activist on behalf of artists. And it was a critical role among a group of, you know, that core group of budding abstract expressionists who had no idea that they were forming a movement, about 10 people, including, you know, Gorky, Bill de Kooning. And so Lee was there from the very beginning, and I think that she and Elaine, the way I approached them was both as painters and because of their importance to the greater scene. So by about, let's say, 1941, when Lee started focusing most of her attention on Pollock's career and kind of receded with her own, then Elaine picked up the baton. And she was the one who became sort of the activist on behalf of artists. She was the first painter to write for Art News. She worked with Tom Hess to make sure that this audience that had never seen an American abstract artist actually began to understand what that meant and who these people were. And so I think that that's how I tried to look at those two. Then when you look at the generation of Grace, Helen, and Joan, you get into them as mostly artists, you know, mostly what was their contribution to the art scene exclusively as through their work. And I think you're right that Helen in 1952 spawned a movement in art called the Color Field School, and she did it at the ripe old age of 23.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, she was so sophisticated in her work as a young woman right out of Bennington that it didn't take her very long to make that leap. And she was so focused in her work. And so She was inspired by Pollock and took that dance that he did in his studio, but instead of skeins of paint or drips of paint, she made oceans, and it was really a fabulous, her first painting, Mountains and Sea, was a fabulous work.
And in your book, you relate, I don't know if I knew this, but that she took the painting home after the show.
Yeah.
It was priced at $100.
Yeah.
Mountains and Sea, one of the great masterpieces of 20th century art.
Yeah.
She carried it home herself. I hope she had help. It's
she
big. It's
had
now
help,
at the
yeah.
National Gallery. And just put it back in her studio.
Yeah.
And then Clem brings his
yeah.
friends to see it,
yeah.
and they take their cue from Helen's painting,
mm-hmm.
and the color field movement is born.
Mm-hmm.
But even when he's writing about it in 60 and 61, she gets a passing
mm-hmm.
reference, and he devotes endless paragraphs mm-hmm. to Morris Lewis and
mm-hmm.
Kenneth Noland.
Yeah, I didn't get into it in the book, but I had a sense, and I may be entirely wrong, but I had a sense that though Helen was extremely bold and free in her work, that up until the time she and Clem broke up in 1955, she was slightly restrained by his influence, because in that period right after they broke up, she really went wild on canvas. She was so experimental. Do you remember those works? Like,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I think I have, I don't know if we have any pictures here, but she tested all the possibilities, and I don't know that she would have done that with Clem.
Mm-hmm.
Not that she felt, well, who knows, in their
who
private
knows?
Lives, yeah, what kind of criticism he gave her, but a new Helen emerged after they broke up.
Well, you could certainly say that Lee Krasner's career began after Pollock's death.
Yes. But you know, there was one thing that I discovered in this research that was new, and I only found it because it was in a little kind of end of a letter Helen had written to her friend, Sonia, that Helen and Lee shared a studio.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it was 1951.
Mm-hmm.
And that was the year that that Lee did the big breakthrough paintings that were the first paintings Pollock ever said, these are really great. And he
mm-hmm.
had Betty Parsons come and look at the paintings
mm-hmm.
and say, you should give Lee a show. And isn't that interesting that Lee, this is one of the things that was so important about this entire movement. These people really fed off one another.
Mm-hmm.
And so there was a dialogue between Helen and Lee in that studio share
mm-hmm.
that Lee was really the beneficiary of. Lee, who was 20 years older than Helen.
When this museum reopened 3 years ago, they had Lee Krasner's The Seasons in the Abstract Expressionist Gallery right in the middle. And I thought that was one of the most powerful, possibly the most powerful moments in the whole museum, because she really held the wall and had no trouble holding her own beside de Kooning and Pollock and all the others. But it's a painting that was done long after his death, I think in the...
I think it was 57.
The Seasons?
Yeah, The Seasons, I think it was 57. Yeah.
57, so right after, a year after his death. Right. And that was interesting. Helen's... The Whitney has a great painting by Helen called The Flood, which I love. That's from the 60s. And that wasn't in the rehanging when the museum reopened, which I found to be a very strange omission.
Mm.
Okay, wait. And here's their fabulous Joan Mitchell that we're looking at. Hemlock.
No, this is Laura, help me out. The Bridge, right.
Right. But
and
is
that,
Hemlock in the
no,
collection?
No, the Bridge actually went to Irving Sandler, I think, owned it.
Okay.
And this
Sorry.
Became this became George went swimming at Barnes Hole, but it got too cold. This is the one she started doing because she was so intimidated painting the bridge because she was, you know, being photographed that she then did that. So if we talk about Joan now for a moment, you know, she was such a fascinating person because she came into the scene with a full classical fine arts education. You know, she and Helen were of that generation. The others before them hadn't had that at all. And so she didn't have a huge leap to make. She had that foundation before she got into to abstraction. But one of the things I found so wonderful about her and so remarkable is that you can really see the influences of the other artists around her in her early work until that 1954 painting City Landscape, when that was Joan, just full on magnificent. And that for me, there was a little crescendo for each of these artists in my writing the book, and that for me was Joan's. It was such a fantastic moment when she'd had a terrible year where she tried to kill herself and her father was very ill, this father who was such a kind of embodied great love, but also, you know, actual emotional abuse. And having been thrown back into that environment in Chicago, she came out of it and did, I think, her best painting up to that point.
Nobody realized at the time that she came from a very wealthy family. She really lived the bohemian life to the fullest. Her mother was editor of Poetry Magazine, but she didn't seem to draw much support from either parent, right?
Well, she did have an income from them, but she wanted to kind of dress down. She always did, even at the Art Institute of Chicago, because she didn't want anyone to think she was rich. Mm-hmm. That was really one of the seven deadly sins.
Jasper Johns just told me a story about going to Washington with her in 1965 to attend a luncheon for LBJ. Believe it or not, I know this is getting weirder and weirder, but presidents used to invite artists to Washington and used to celebrate artists, if you can believe that. So they drove down together, and suddenly Adlai Stevenson walked by, and he waved at them, and he said, "Hi, Joni." And Jasper thought, wait, she can't belong to the same world that I do. Yeah. How does she know Adlai Stevenson? Her family was so connected. Mm-hmm. And but you wouldn't know it spending time with her.
Right.
She was tough, and she lived a rough life and drank heavily and I think was the most profane of the group.
Probably, yeah. But you know, it's interesting too. One of the criticisms, I mentioned this in the book, one of the criticisms of these women is that they tried to be like the boys, and they talk about Joan with her, you know, foul mouth, and Elaine and Grace with their drinking. And in fact, you know, it's silly, because these people, these women, were who they were before they arrived on the scene. When Joan was a child, she spoke, you know, she talked like a sailor. So by the time she got to New York, you know, she was well versed in that language. She didn't have to learn it. And then as far as Grace goes, you know, the fascinating thing about her is that she came in between the two generations. She was after Lee and Elaine, but before Helen and Joan. And she had the most conventional sort of womanly upbringing. You know, she was a mother, a wife. She had worked in an insurance company.
She was the only one who had a child.
She had a
in
child.
Your book. She was the only of the five artists, the only one who had a child. That was
she
very
had a child.
Interesting.
And she actually took the greatest chances in her life, because there was absolutely nothing in her background, in her present, or for what she could see in her future, that would have ensured her any kind of success as an artist.
But isn't that true of all of them?
Yes and no. I mean, she had no cushion. She had no safety net, you know, at all. And she had no one encouraging her. And she had had no experience with artists other than her first artist lover, who was a guy twice her age, who only actually moved with her to New York because he thought Grace would support him financially. So, but then she walked into Pollock's first drip show at Betty Parsons, and you know, the earth moved for her, and she gave up her son, and that was it. And she was a painter. And you know, the strength of that woman is amazing. And what she did, you know, the job she took, the situations, you know, in which she lived with Al Leslie on Essex Street. They had no heat, no hot water, no electricity. They had nothing. Mm-hmm. You know, they were basically camping in New York City, and she was all in.
The circumstances of hardship are really remarkable. Mm-hmm. I was just discussing with some friends here a detail in your book about de Kooning saying that he would go to the Waldorf cafeteria and have tomato soup.
Yeah.
By which he meant he would take a pack of ketchup, which was free, and dilute it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I get the impression that Elaine would tell that story, and I get the impression that she would say that he had tomato soup because she had no soup at all. I mean, I don't think she subsisted on anything other than just, you know, entertainment, her work, and his work. And she was likely a, you know, great promoter of her husband, not just because she was a wifey. I think, as Natalie Edgar, if she's here, and I hope she is, as Natalie Edgar said, Elaine wasn't a wifey. She was a lover of art, and she saw in her husband a genius, which she recognized from the beginning. And so it wasn't that she was making sacrifices because that was her duty. It was because it was a greater duty, a duty to art.
She was a great free spirit.
Yeah.
I think she was a fabulous writer. I would love to see a collected volume of her writings.
Wouldn't that be fantastic?
And she was a very different wife than Krasner, obviously.
Right.
Krasner,
mm-hmm.
in some ways, you could say, was a more traditional wife,
right.
because she was totally devoted to her husband,
right.
although he was hardly traditional, and had trouble doing her own work. She famously painted in the upstairs bedroom of the house.
Which was a very small room.
While
very,
he
very
had
small.
The barn.
Mm-hmm.
And she also helped create his market, you explained.
Yes, that's really fascinating. You know, so here Lee was at the beginning of this movement, you know, 1930s, helping to create it along with these other people. And at the moment when the art world had awakened to the idea that there were American artists in the mid-1950s. Lee, Pollock had died, and Lee, with the business DNA that she had, she wasn't in any way a trained businesswoman, but she knew the market so well because she'd been in that world for such a long time. When Pollock died, the MoMA had been offered, prior to his death, MoMA had been offered his painting Autumn Rhythm for $8,000, and Alfred Barr said, no way, we're not gonna pay that. And so then Pollock died, and Lee told Sidney Janis to increase the price to $30,000. And, you know, and it's not that Lee had a lot of money and she could roll the dice. She said, I think she had $200 or $300 in her checking account when he died. And at that time, Jackson Pollock, we have to remember, was not Jackson Pollock. He was, if he had died without Lee there to promote him, I don't know that we would even know about him, really, because you need that person to pick up the ball, you know, as and construct your legacy. But anyway, so Lee tripled the price, and the Metropolitan Museum of Art bought it. And from that moment on, someone said it was much easier to sell it to Kooning for $10,000 after that week than it had been to sell it for $5,000 the week before. So all of the prices went crazy.
Mm-hmm. Did you have a favorite? Oh, before I get into that. One thing I found astounding was that Grace Hartigan had such a large career in the 50s.
Yes.
Alfred Barr adored her and bought her, it's the Persian jacket.
Yeah, that was the first of the second generation painters to
enter
get
a museum in 53.
Yeah.
And her, she had her painting at the Whitney.
Grand Street Brides. Yeah.
Also entered the museum in the 50s.
Yes. Yeah, she was really, of any of the second generation artists, male or female, she was the most famous, and which is, like I said, it's so remarkable because she went from 0 to 100 in about 4 years.
And then her career fell off, most sharply also. She moved to Baltimore in 1960, and she really devoted herself to figurative work.
Yeah, not for a while, but eventually, yeah.
And I think that her reputation... weakened over time.
I think it was mostly a matter of distance, because if you can imagine, you know, Baltimore in those days was really nowhere, you know, as far as the art world was concerned. New York was practically nowhere.
But you wrote the book on the Cohn sisters, on the Cohn heads.
Yeah,
you can't say Baltimore's nowhere.
Well,
they have a great museum.
That they do. But from the point of view of a New York gallery owner, you know, it's tough enough for you to make the leap to represent a woman in New York, let alone a woman in Baltimore. You know, she walked off the map, basically, in the art world.
But do you think you had to be in New York in those years?
Did.
That's a very interesting question.
I think
do you,
you
need
did.
To be here?
I think you did.
In order to make great art.
It was all about connections. At the beginning, it was about influence, you know, the artists influencing one another. And so you fed off each other and positively.
And you see the shows.
And you see the shows and you're part of the conversation. And then at the end of the 50s, it was all about being part of the market. You had to be accessible to these people so they could come and look at your work. You know, to schlep down to Baltimore to see somebody's paintings is just a train trip too far if they can just walk across the street and see somebody's painting in a, you know what I mean? In a studio.
It's an interesting point. I would think you could have a major career at Baltimore, but I won't press it. The Meyerhoffs could come by, buy a painting.
Yeah. Yeah.
But she left, and Joan Mitchell left New York around this time, and of course, when I visited her, she was in Vitaille, France, living in Monet's former house, and she very much identified with the tradition of European landscape painting.
Right.
I mean, she took Abex in a very interesting direction. Some people really prefer her later works. Mm.
I noticed just last week that Roberta Smith actually picked on her early paintings from the 50s, which surprised me in a review, because I love those 50s paintings. Mm-hmm. I think they're just so tough. They're so different. And they kind of have, and they're full of nature as well. Mm-hmm. You see what's coming when you look at them. Mm-hmm. But later on, the work does sort of blossom. Yeah. It gets calmer and greener. And some people prefer the later works. Mm-hmm. But so she had a career away from New York.
Right. She did, but she didn't, you know, first of all, she was wealthy.
That's true.
She didn't care. I mean,
she knew Adlai Stevenson.
Yeah. She didn't care. She's, you know, I mean, it was to you she said, I'm not creating palm olive soap, didn't she? I think it was in your interview where she just went off, did her own work, and that was what was most important to her, you know, the act of creation, where she wanted to take the painting. She didn't necessarily need to be in a scene.
She was a brilliant painter. I think she's really first rate.
And I think one of the reasons she
left... That helps too, right?
I think one of the reasons she left in the late 50s is that she was essentially as bombastic as she could be and as you know, wild and challenging as she could be personally. She was very shy. And when the art market turned into something where a situation where you had to try to sell yourself as much as your art, you know, that was part of Grace's reason for leaving too, is that she suddenly became part of the product. She had to be on show. She had to make the scene as Grace Hartigan, the artist, not just someone working in their studio and their paintings speak for themselves. And when Joan saw the direction that the art world was going, she just wasn't prepared for it psychologically. She just didn't care to be part of that. But there was a purer kind of, let's say in Europe, you could just be an artist. She would say, you don't have to explain what that means. Mm-hmm. And so she could retreat into her work and create and not be bothered by the salesmanship part of it.
Well, now that I think about it, I think they all left New York at the end of the 50s because Lee was out in East Hampton. She came back, though. She came back to Manhattan.
And Elaine moved.
Where was Elaine? She was teaching all over the country. She left, too.
Yeah, and then she came back.
And who's the fifth one?
Who
we
Helen.
And Helen was here.
Yeah, she was here. She was
here.
Uptown.
Upper East Side.
Yeah. Upper Bohemian. So I mean, everything changed, and that's when, unfortunately, when the art world became the art market and business became what painting was all about, buying and selling.
But they continued to do good. I mean,
what's
interesting
is
Lee's work, I would say, got better in the 60s. I mean, it's not, you know, they could distance themselves from the market.
Right.
They had suffered through the lean years.
Yeah.
She had studied with Hans Hofmann. She knew more about European modernism than anybody else of that generation. Mm-hmm. She's often given credit for introducing Pollock to Picasso, meaning Picasso's work, not the person. Mm-hmm. And so, of course, she was grounded. Mm-hmm. And I don't think that she was... I don't think that the market changed her life at all, except to make her more financially comfortable. I think that... And of all those artists, Joan Mitchell, certainly not ruined by the market.
No, but what I was going to say is that it became more difficult for most women at the moment when art was valued for its price tag as opposed to the quality of the painting. Most women fell off the map at that point. You know, people often ask me what happened to, you know, if this was a moment when women were recognized for their art, like this, this image is from the Life magazine piece. What happened? Where did they go? And where they went was, you know, pop. And collectors stopped buying women, and museums stopped requesting, you know, that women's work be donated, and critics stopped writing about them. I mean, some of the people here, like Barbara Tuchman, is one of the few women who kept those women alive for us, for the likes of...
But which women?
For any of these women, I mean, you yourself, you know, your interviews with Lee through the years, or Barbara Rose's interviews with Lee through the years, if it hadn't been for your work, I wonder sometimes where they would have gone. They would have been fine.
I don't see it as that dire. I think what's interesting is, reading your book, I realized that the museums were more supportive of them than critics. The real problems were their fellow artists, their husbands, and Clement Greenberg. You know, you talk about how he would rail against women artists. He really thought women were inferior artists, that they polished their work too much. The work had too much finish. They didn't know when to end a painting. He made it sound like they were polishing a table with lemon pledge, the way he described them painting. And then when Helen had her show, I was fascinated by the criticism. People yeah. said that because she poured paint and created these beautiful veils of color, there was no sign of struggle.
Yes, isn't that amazing?
Which is really interesting. So they use that as a way to attack her. The work mm-hmm. is too surfacey. Mm-hmm. It's not about smearing. Mm-hmm. It's not about erasing. Mm-hmm. And then later on, that becomes a mark of genius among
yes.
other artists
right.
who avoid this mm-hmm. great metaphysical mm-hmm. struggle in their work. Mm-hmm. But so I think the artists, I think they paved the way for a lot of artists who mm-hmm. came afterwards. There were quite a few women who painted mm-hmm. in that era
mm-hmm. Yeah.
compared to earlier eras. I mean, if we go back before Lee, you have Georgia O'Keeffe and Mary
Cassatt.
Right,
right. They were individuals, but really, I think the idea of women being professional artists really arose in the WPA with mm-hmm. Lee, and mm-hmm. because they were getting the same paycheck as men, and they were in it, and they were all treated the same. They were interchangeable. So I think that's where it came from. And so there was a beautiful kind of 20-year period.
That's interesting. And maybe the art world, like the rest of the world, just had to wait for the 70s and the women's movement
yeah.
and the idea that men could help at home, mm-hmm. help raise children and wash dishes, right?
Mm.
Whenever I think of carpeting, I know this is slightly to the side, but not yeah. completely. When I look at old magazines and see all the ads for carpet and carpet cleaners, I think women who had a vacuum couldn't get anything else done. Mm-hmm. It's like it really held them back.
Yeah.
And then they got rid of all the carpet.
Yeah.
And look what women did. You know,
yeah.
I think that now, when there are so many women artists, and women who have, I think, probably much less difficult lives than your pioneers, mm-hmm. people have, many women artists have children now, mm-hmm. and that really seemed to be almost an impossibility.
Yes. Yeah.
In the 50s.
Yeah.
Why is that? Why do you think
I think that the life was basically so difficult, and mm-hmm. you know, to split your time between raising a child and trying to create art. And plus, you know, the art world that they lived in. I mean, it was difficult enough to be a woman artist, to be a mother.
Oh.
You know, impossible. Do you
remember they didn't have enough money for help, really.
Yeah. And where would you put a child? I mean, when Grace brought her son to her loft with L. Leslie, you know, in this place, this camping space on the Lower East Side, you know, that's not a way to raise a child. Do you remember the anecdote with Louise Nevelson where, I think I use it in the book, I'm not sure, but a critic actually stated in 1944 that I was glad to learn that this was done by a woman, because otherwise I would have declared this work to be done by a master. So in other words, he was saying, you know, so if that's what a woman was up against, then just think what a mother would have been up against. I mean, you would have been written off. But
and most of the men of that generation did not have children either.
Yes.
I mean, I think the only parents were Jack Twerkov was always kind of cited as a great father.
Mm. Ibram Lasow.
Ibram, right, Lasso, and mm-hmm. And Rothko had mm-hmm. children,
mm-hmm.
but many of them were too poor
mm-hmm.
to think about
yeah.
raising a family, and in many cases, the wives supported the husbands, like mm-hmm. Annalee
yes.
Newman, of course.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. But as to your point about the 70s and women today and, you know, this kind of wave, just as the feminist movement comes in waves, just the social feminist movement, mm-hmm. so too does the recognition of women artists come in waves.
Mm-hmm.
And I think we're at a point now that someone said to me, which I think was a really excellent point, that, you know, prices have been, there have been new records set for women's work, and there's a new focus on women's work. But for that to remain, you know, for that not to then go the its inevitable dip, there has to be a real shift in the way women are treated, that they have to be taught in art history courses and they have to be shown in museums and that they have to become part of the discussion.
Well, that's, I feel like the market, this might be naive, is a whole nother issue. I don't really think about the market that much.
Well, that's great, but unfortunately...
you wrote on Marx, so you probably more Marxian view
with
funny
the because
market
this...
and the art. I feel like that most artists are untouched by the market, first of all.
They're not selling?
Because they're not in the auctions to begin with.
Right.
So, I mean, this is just like, to me, the auctions are like this cartoon strip
Yes.
That runs along the edge of the art world.
Yeah.
That involves like 30 artists.
Mm-hmm.
Who most people are not touched by mm-hmm. it. And for those who are touched by it, many of them remain really insulated
mm-hmm.
from
what about
its more pernicious mm-hmm. effects.
Yes.
I mean, I think we can think of many people whose work sells well and who really seem to be digging as deeply into themselves
mm-hmm.
as they ever were. So
right.
I don't see the market as necessarily being compromising. I think it's compromising for other reasons.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's wounding for artists because it's, you know, I just can't believe looking through auction catalogs that you could see what everyone is worth. Imagine if writers had their advances published. I mean, that's a very
yes.
demeaning structure
right.
in a way. It's like horse races. What is your value? And it's annoying because people outside the art world think that price actually reflects on talent.
Right.
I don't think it does.
No, it doesn't. And you're absolutely right. And if a person is a real artist, they're going to create no matter what, if anybody's looking at their work. But the point is that for people getting in, you know, artists paint to show their friends or their family or hopefully at galleries. And for those gallery doors to open, there has to be someone at the top. You know, there has to be someone at the top of the heap that is sort of paving the way, you know, that it's the road to Oz so that you get in the gallery and you can work mm-hmm. through that system. And
mm-hmm.
I agree absolutely that the creation of art and the selling of art are two different things and they shouldn't actually influence one another. But I think, in fact, they do.
Mm-hmm.
And
mm-hmm.
I think that, you know, there's a moment now where maybe there's a leveling off. There was someone at the Frankenthaler Institute yesterday who, a young woman who was a painter, and it was so refreshing because she said that there's not really a difference now in galleries at her age, at her mm-hmm. stage, between men and women.
Mm-hmm.
Great. You know, isn't that wonderful? But,
well,
you know,
prices, you're right, men get much more at auction. I think the only female artist who really is in that stratosphere is Cindy Sherman.
Mm.
And women do lag behind. But I wouldn't, yeah, I feel
they
like.
They are two different things.
I don't see that as a terrible mm-hmm. injustice. I just see that as part of the bias
mm-hmm.
Of a market that might not really even understand which art is the most interesting.
No, and it won't, and you know, we'll find out 40 years from now who was the most interesting artist.
Because the injustice is not that some artists aren't selling paintings for $100 million, that
right.
women artists aren't selling. The injustice is, are they represented
right.
at the Museum of Modern Art?
Right.
That's much more important.
Yes.
Do they have gallery representation? Do critics take them seriously?
Mm-hmm.
And reading your book, I was aware that even the female critics of the era were writing about men, like Barbara
yes.
Rose, who we both adore,
yeah.
was writing mostly about male mm-hmm. artists, minimalism.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. And Dori Ashton
mm-hmm.
also wrote a lot about Rothko and Gustin
mm-hmm.
And these women did not have their champion. Didn't have champions.
Well, Dori Ashton was a big champion of Grace. She really loved mm-hmm. Grace, and she, you mm-hmm. know, couldn't understand why she fell off the map. But I think it became kind of a loop, you know, that when, I mean, critics write what's being shown, and if women aren't being shown, they're not writing about women. And, you know, I mean, if a woman's not in the gallery.
Mm-mm. Well, look at Clem. Helen was showing.
Right.
And Clem didn't write about her. I mean, you look at his book from 1960, Art and Culture. They had been dating for a decade.
Yeah,
and there
years,
are endless
yeah.
references to mm-hmm. Pollock and everyone else in the
mm-hmm.
book. But I think that the male critics, or you look at Janssen's History of
yeah.
Art.
It has 14 women in now
yeah.
or something.
It
for
has
a long
14
time,
women.
It had none.
So, I mean, a lot of this, I think, does have mm-hmm. to do with the critics, the scholars,
yes.
the husbands,
yes,
as opposed to dealers. I mean, dealers mm. will show anything that can sell.
Yeah, but
so
they'll
they
sell
have,
whatever people want. And
that's
people
true.
Don't know
okay.
what they want until they've been introduced to it. And so it's a vicious cycle. All I'm saying
yeah.
is that we're at this point right now. So let's keep it there.
Yeah, no, we're at this very strange moment where galleries are really trying and museums are trying to be more inclusive. Society as a whole wants to be more inclusive. And there are endless debates about this. Is the quality of art being compromised?
Mm-hmm.
Or do we want to be a more inclusive society? This is the way the argument is often framed. And you know, I think we're at a great moment. Mm-hmm. I mean, the big thing in the art world now is revisionism. Mm-hmm. We're looking back and seeing how we can expand the mm-hmm. canon. Mm-hmm. And you know, so what if we overlook a Kenneth Noland mm-hmm. For 5 minutes? You know, yeah. they'll be back. It's nice yeah. to focus on women and minorities, I mm-hmm. think, right now. I think mm-hmm. that does.
That's a really good point, and that's something that I think is so critical, because oftentimes people will say, well, in focusing on women, you're ignoring a lot of good men. I don't think that there's, you know, art appreciation is like a heart. You know, that heart can have enough love in it for everybody, and so can art appreciation. You don't have to have a very small world. It's not either or. You can like everyone, or you can at least be introduced to as many people as possible.
Well, the fashion now definitely is for women artists, mm-hmm. I think, and minority artists. If you look at the exhibition calendars at the museums this year, and I think it's a moment of cultural reckoning
yeah.
that reflects a larger cultural yeah. reckoning that seems to me generally like a force for good. And mm-hmm. I think the people who argue that this represents somehow a dipping in quality, as critics used to yeah. argue, it's just an old formalist
yes.
argument
right.
that doesn't hold up. I mean, there's always a lot of good work out there to look at.
Mm-hmm.
And I'd rather be looking at this right now.
Yeah.
I think it's wonderful yeah. that you've brought so much attention to work that wasn't unknown, yeah. I would say. But
no, it wasn't unknown.
But you've allowed us to see what these women went through.
Yeah.
And they had no champions. The mm-hmm. men had so many champions.
Mm. Yeah.
You know, between Harold Rosenberg, who we haven't discussed.
Yes.
Who lived to promote de Kooning mm-hmm. and Clem and Pollock, and they mm-hmm. each had a horse in the race.
Mm-hmm. One of the stories that I felt was important in my book, that, you know, you say the women didn't have champions. Well, Grace had Frank O'Hara as a champion.
That's true.
Which was really incredible, because Frank had, when he went back to the Museum of Modern Art to work in the international program, from that moment, Grace was represented in all of the important traveling shows.
Oh, no.
And I don't think it was because, I mean, he and Grace were the closest of friends, but I don't think that was the only reason.
I don't think it was a reason at all. Because Alfred Barr supported
exactly,
her early on.
And the Rockefellers did.
Mm-hmm.
But that was a really interesting relationship, because he made sure, his first book of poetry that was published by Barney Rossett, Barney wanted someone else, I think it was Bob Goodnow, to do the cover.
Mm.
And Frank, in letter after letter, said, no, I really want Grace to do it. And then Barney would write back and say, well, you know, I think we should have there must have been, I don't know, maybe 10 letters going back and forth between the two of them. And Frank stuck to his guns, and Grace did the cover for it. And so he was a powerful voice who was working for her.
A great person to mm-hmm. have on your side.
Yes. Yeah, that was one of the other things in this book that I really enjoyed. The focus has not just been on a few men, but there were a lot of figures, other artists, other writers, composers, mm-hmm. who made up the personality of that period, who mm-hmm. were fantastic to write about, so much fun. And without them, there is no story. And oftentimes, mm-hmm. especially when you're focusing on just one person, it becomes difficult to include all of these other peripheral figures. But that's why I kind of made a stew of this book and threw everyone in there. Because
it's hard to pull it together, though,
yeah.
weaving all that material together.
Yeah. But
did you find that very difficult? Did
not
you
really,
have to?
No.
Did you constantly think, where am I going to put Morton Feltman or
no,
John
because,
Cage? Where is he going?
No, because they entered at a certain moment.
Yeah.
It was really kind of, it wasn't that difficult, to be honest with you. There was a certain chronology to it, you know, in the movement. I know that some people have observed that there was sort of not plotting, but the earlier movement was slower. And then all of a sudden it exploded. And indeed it did, because that's what happened. You know, mm-hmm. the book follows that. There was, you know, a few very serious, dedicated artists. And then 1950 happened, and, you know, the world changed in that sort of heavy post-war period. You know, that soul-searching post-war period had ended. And the go-go 50s consumerism had started. And then the various GIs who'd been studying, you know, wild things. I mean, to imagine that the government paid for Larry Rivers to study music, and, you know, it's just so much fun to think about that. The government paying Larry Rivers to do anything. But So they all, you know, they all came together, and it was this, you know, pardon the cliche, this incredible flowering. So I tried to get all of that in there, and hopefully, it was as if they were knocking on the door and saying, "It's my turn to come into the story," and there they would be.
Did you find that you liked writing about one of the women more than the others?
No, I really didn't. I thought I might, because at the beginning, you know, having met Grace, and so the story began with her, I thought she would be the one that I would favor, maybe. But I didn't. And then Elaine, I felt instinctively, you know, I felt culturally in every way kind of attuned to her.
Because she was a writer?
Yeah, because she was a writer. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I felt like I understood her and her love of portraiture. When I was an art student, I really loved portraits. You know, I'm not at all good at flights of fancy. And so I appreciated where she was coming from, you know, that she was writing portraits both in words and in painting. And but then, you know, as I met all of them and got to know all of them, I really enjoyed each and every one. And by the end of the book, I hated to give any of them up. Mm-hmm. So anyway, did you have a favorite? You knew them all.
I think I was most moved by Helen Frankenthaler, mm-hmm. because I never realized before that Clem never wrote about her.
But you had written about her.
I had written about her myself. Yeah. I know. I must have known. But, you know, I took down his volumes. I was in disbelief that she dated this man. She met him in 1950, and his first collection comes out in 61. He doesn't mention her, and she is the creator of the movement that he extols after Pollock, meaning color field painting. And I just thought, you know, he was such an underminer. Mm-hmm. How did she get any work done? It's amazing she was ambulatory.
Yeah.
So I just thought it took remarkable strength mm-hmm. in that era. I'm wondering, do you think the fact that they were all abstract painters or semi-abstract painters made it easier for them to assert themselves?
I think it might have.
Because you couldn't segregate paintings to male or female subjects.
I think that might have helped. Because if they had started out with either a kind of a semi-abstraction or figurative works or landscapes or whatever, they would have been more easily pigeonholed, I think. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But I think abstract painting was a language that, you know, transcended gender.
It transcended gender, mm-hmm. which is very interesting. Mm-hmm. And now, of course, artists want to embrace gender mm-hmm. and difference and autobiography. Mm-hmm. We're in a very different moment. Mm-hmm. But it's interesting because if you compare a Grace Hartigan next to, let's see, whose work does it next to James Brooks, for instance.
Yeah.
You couldn't say which one was painted by a man and which one was painted by a woman.
Or there's a Larry Rivers upstairs, a really great Larry Rivers. I don't know if you saw it. I think it's from 1960. Completely, almost completely abstract. And that you couldn't say, that could have been by Grace. You know, it would be impossible to figure out if it was a man or a woman. And even though people would say that, you know, sometimes Joan in her moments would accuse Helen of painting like a woman, I don't think that you could really, if you look at a Rothko or a Frankenthaler, I don't really think you could say one was done by a man and one was done by a woman. And definitely not one of Joan's paintings. You know, the energy in her work, maybe the later works, mm-hmm. but then, you know, then you've got Monet. And so, you know, you can't say hers are more lyrical than his work. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. And you really romanticize the 50s. I do too. I do too. But I'm not sure that the art world was better when everyone was starving.
Yeah, I know.
It's tempting. It is. It was Bohemia's last flare in the United States.
Yeah, yeah.
And it was an incredibly romantic movement, and clearly no one was in it for the money.
Right.
But I still think no one ever really became an artist to make money.
No.
I mean, that would be a foolish thing
to do. It was a foolish thing to do. Right. It was a foolish thing to do. And no one even considered it. For the first...
No, but now even I don't think anybody goes into art for that reason.
I'm sure some people do. But...
No. I mean, there's so many easier ways to make money than being an artist.
Yeah,
anything
probably.
Is easier, probably. Basically.
Yeah.
So, you know, I don't think people get into it. For that reason.
Yeah.
That's all I wanted to say. So I feel like artists, some of you might disagree. I know there are a lot of critics here, but I feel like artists are as earnest now as they were in the 50s. Everybody's doing their best. Nobody ever set out to make a bad painting.
No, I agree with that.
But the 50s does have, it still is mesmerizing.
Why is that?
I think it's
because it was the first real revolution. You know, we've had political revolutions in the United States, but this was the first artistic revolution. And it was so, it was, you know, it, I mean, I say over and over again in the book, but it changed the history of art for the Western world, and I suppose beyond. And I think that that's part of it, that revolutions are always romantic. And this one was romantic because everyone was in it together. You know, in a talk I give for this book, I say that women weren't daughters of the revolution. They were soldiers in the revolution. And that was really true, that they were in it completely, you know, with up to here with the same sacrifices, as dedicated in their art, you know, prowling the same bars and the same streets as the men at all the wrong hours. So they were completely in it. And I think that's just what's a, plus it's beyond painting and sculpting, you know, the music of that time. Like the five spot anecdote where they're there at night watching, you know, and Billie Holiday creeps in and starts singing. I mean, that's just irresistible stuff. So, and they're there, you know, and not making a big deal out of it, although they all loved Billie Holiday. So I think that it's just, it's a fascinating time. And as you say, it was kind of the last, I think of it as the last pure moment in art, you know, when artists were kind of left alone to do their work and without heavy-handed criticism. A lot of the critics that wrote about art in the 50s were actually other artists. You know, when you look at the little initials of who wrote the piece.
In Art News.
It would be Fairfield Porter, or it would be Frank O'Hara, or it would be, you know, one of the pals. And so the criticism was very gentle.
They created the art, and they were the audience for the art.
Right. Yeah, and they created the dialogue.
Everyone always says that when you went to a Merce Cunningham performance in that era, you knew everyone in the audience. And it was the same people from one performance to the next. And the people who were creating the art were supporting their... Oh, we'd love to have the audience.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Oh, yeah. So sorry, we got carried away.
Questions? Anybody questions? Observations? Criticisms? Protests?
Yeah, Jim. Oh, I think we need a...
And can you say your name before you ask the question, please? Thanks.
Yes, hi. I'm Helen's niece, Ellen Eisman, and I just want to thank you so much for a really beautiful presentation. And I'm very proud of my aunt, wherever she is, looking down, and I'm sure
you're
she
Helen's
would be...
niece, we
Ellen.
Should say.
Yeah,
yeah.
My older, my mom was Marjorie Frankenthaler, her older sister, and also probably her best friend, too.
Yeah.
So we were very close, and I'm very moved by tonight's presentation. I just wanted to ask, because you spoke about the pendulum inevitably swinging, and I just wondered, you know, 40 or 50 years from now, do you think these artists are still going to be talked about and kind of revered as pioneers and so forth, or will other names have taken their place?
It's hard to say, you know, it's hard to predict, but I can't see if anybody in 40 or 50 years are still talking about Bill de Kooning and Jackson Pollock. I would hope that they would still be talking about Helen Frankenthaler and Lee Krasner and Elaine de Kooning and Grace Hartigan and Joan Mitchell, because I hope that through this book and through the shows that are going to be coming up, there's a big Mitchell retrospective coming up, and you know, the exhibitions that Museum of Modern Art had and the Denver Museum had, I hope that these women are taking their rightful place in history and that they'll remain there. So I can't see why they wouldn't, based on the quality of their work.
I say definitely. The 50s are seen as the heroic era in American painting. And it's always foolish to predict who will last.
Yeah.
But I think they'll all be exhibited forever.
Yeah.
Thank
yeah.
you very much. I think Helen would be very happy to hear
that. I'm sure she's watching this somewhere.
Do we have a question over here?
Jim, yeah.
I'm Jim Levis. I'm quite curious about your perspective on the issue of the power of the last name. As of the five artists, four of them had their own name, their own name identity. Mm-hmm. Elaine de Kooning being the outsider in that regard. What, in your mind's eye, if any, challenges do you think that presented to Elaine then and now? Mm-hmm.
I think that it probably, you know, in some ways, the name recognition probably opened some doors but in the art world, but I think that ultimately it might have hurt Elaine because she's always a wife of, you know, with the name de Kooning. And Elaine was so strong in every way in her life and in her art and in her writing that Elaine Fried, I think, would have done just fine, you know, without being Elaine de Kooning. So I think in her case it might have hurt. But then again, I have to say, I can't even imagine her not being Elaine de Kooning. You know, that's who she is. So I don't know, you know, but I think it might have hurt. What do you think? What is your thought?
It's a good name to have.
Yeah.
Mary de Kooning, Deborah de Kooning. I'm changing my name. Yeah. But it's interesting how many women in the history of art attach themselves to great artists. And I was just saying to somebody, the only one I think who really surpassed her husband, I know this is dangerous, is Frida Kahlo. Mm.
Yeah.
Who possibly surpassed Diego Rivera. I mean, he's a great artist. I don't mean to turn it into a contest, but, you know, she attached herself to somebody who was well known at the time and was ignored by much of the art world. And many women attached themselves. Georgia O'Keeffe attached herself to Stieglitz, Mary Cassatt, married the brother of Manet, and I just think there were so few opportunities for women that they went wherever they could and wherever the opportunities were, and that was one way to not necessarily even enhance their careers, but to be part of the art world, to be part of the conversations, and that's what they lived for.
Yeah, but you know, it's funny, this whole idea of attaching themselves to a more powerful man. You know, Elaine and Lee were married to big figures. But the next generation, Grace, Joan, and Helen, even though Helen was dating Clem and married Bob Motherwell, I didn't think, when I was writing about them, I never thought of them as getting a boost by those relationships.
No, no.
At all.
No.
And I think that, especially for Grace and Joan, I mean, the men in their lives didn't help one bit. Barney might have, just as a... Through Joan's life, Barney was always a sounding board
Barney
and kind
Rossett.
Of like a brother, Barney Rossett. But the other men in their lives, if anything, were kind of a drag. I hope that's
definitely,
not unfair.
Definitely.
But, yeah.
Yeah. So do you think they were pointing more toward the future? What
yeah.
is what is the but now it's now it seems like it's a different situation altogether, whereas women don't have to necessarily be out there alone on the cliff if they're an artist. I mean, they can find some comfortable social role as well.
Yeah, I think Grace called it a congenial partner.
A congenial partner, that's nice to have.
Yeah. Yeah, it's very handy. Does anyone else have any questions?
I was gonna ask you a question.
Yeah.
Oh, sorry. Unless there's an... I noticed, I mean, there are so many foundations now. There are so many artist foundations. And I was wondering, did you work closely with the foundations and was everybody supportive of you?
Yes. Yes, they were. And I'm not just saying that because they're here. No, they
How
were.
How does that
I
work?
Mean,
I mean, do
I
they have
so,
all the papers there? And...
Yeah, the Mitchell Foundation and the Frankenthaler Foundation have, you know, incredible treasure troves of primary material, which are... You know, it's as good as, well, not as good as sitting down with a living person, but pretty close. And sometimes maybe it is as good because their letters are very candid
of
because
course.
They never expect the likes of me, you know, will be reading them. So, and then I had the benefit of having the families of the other artists who were just really wonderful. And Lee's papers are all at the Archives of American Art, which is an incredible resource for anyone writing. So between, you know, the living, the family members, the foundations, the archives, and the many, many people who have written about these people, not just what they've written, but the tapes that they've collected, you know, the interviews they did for people who are now long dead, all of it I was able to bring together and to create this, you know, constant.
Did any of the anybody say to you, why are you pairing these
no.
women? Why maybe Lee doesn't want to be with Helen?
No, no one
no
said
one
that.
Said
yeah,
that.
yeah.
That's
no,
good.
They were too polite. Yeah.
Well, I think it's a very risky approach that you pulled off brilliantly.
But it seemed to be, you know, I looked at a lot of the painters, you know, from that period and tried to see if I'm going to do a group, you know, as I said in the introduction, I didn't think to do one of them would be able to allow me to tell the story as Grace told me. You know, mm-hmm. she told me, you know, over a period of 4 hours, she told me, you know, just a wild story of a party, you know, what Elaine called the 10-year party, but it was actually a 30-year party. and I didn't think I could tell that story through one person because merely, you know, the time span. So I looked for characters who would lead me through the whole abstract expressionist period. And these five did it so neatly, you know, and not only were they because of their art, but because of their importance to the movement and
yeah, but
chronologically.
You're a good storyteller because no one's even written the male version of that. I mean, there's not.
Yeah.
Is there a group portrait of abstract expressionism?
There's
Can
a
anybody
lot of history
think
of
one?
There are a lot of
there
histories.
There are a lot of histories, of course, yeah. starting with The Triumph of American Painting by Irving Sandler. But in terms of a really rich group portrait, it hasn't been done. Mm. And now it's too late. We don't want
yeah,
to. We feel like we've read it.
Yeah.
But I think it's very hard to weave that many narratives together. I don't know how you brought all that information together and stayed organized. Yeah. And
at the time,
what does your desk look like?
No, I think at the time, I'm sure, and I'm 100% sure that there were moments of crises, but it really wasn't that difficult because they all just fell into place. They were very helpful.
Nobody, there was no one who said, I don't want to help you?
Yes, but I'm not going to mention the name.
Excellent.
Yeah.
You're very diplomatic.
Yeah, yeah.
All right, so do we have any other? Oh, another question, yes.
Yeah, my name is Steve Lambert. There was an exhibition, I think, 2 years ago that started out in Denver that went to Palm Springs that had another, I think, four women, Sonia Geltoff, if I'm not mistaken.
Mm-hmm.
Don't forget the other three women. I don't remember their name. Their names. Any reason why one or two of the others were not in this particular book? Because they all seem to be related somehow.
Yeah, yeah. I just had to, you know, you see the size of the book. I had to kind of, you know, narrow it down. And I wish that I could have gotten more in. But I did, you know, when Deborah asked me about organizing, I couldn't go too far afield. You know, those women weren't really part of this core group. And, you know, I could have written about five other women, and it would have been an entirely different story about an entire...
Did you consider any others? What about Louise Nevelson?
No, because
I only
stuck with painters.
Oh,
so there's the sculpture book out there for someone to do. But I think you're absolutely right. There were some people, and, you know, I might have written more about Pearl Fine or Hedda Stern. Mm-hmm. And in the second generation, Nell Blaine and Jane Freilicher are great figures. So, but, you know, what... That means that somebody else can do it.
Any more questions? I can't really see out there. Okay, well.
I think we should all have a drink to toast.
We're
going to
have a drink. Thank you all. Thanks you all for coming and for supporting the great women artists of America. Oh, I think you better find it. Love is always a feeling, and it's in a game. In your heart, 'cause I ain't gonna break it.